Guys, can you start? So hello, and thank you for having me here today. It's a pleasure to be here at DevConf to talk about a topic that I'm very, very passionate about, WebAssembly. So before I get started, I just wanted to ask you guys a question, right? How many of you here have heard about WebAssembly? Raise your hands. Okay, that's actually a good number. So WebAssembly is actually being termed as the future of web. Right, that's a huge term, right? Like no one just simply gives the technology the next future. So today in this talk, I'm gonna basically introduce you guys to WebAssembly and talk about why so fast and what is so exciting about it. On this note, let me introduce my title. My title is Hacker's Guide to WebAssembly. So it's a bit relevant to share about myself. I'm Vigneshwer. During the day, I'm an AI researcher back in Bangalore. I do crazy things like the ones that's there in the booth there over there, Rad Analytics. But during the night, I'm a Mozilla contributor. Today here, I'm representing Mozilla as a tech speaker, which is a developer outreach program by Mozilla that basically trains highly enthusiastic volunteers like me to go out to developer-facing conference like DevConf to do and talk about Mozilla technologies and initiatives. You can write to me at dvigneshwer@gmail.com, and I'm at @dvigneshwer on Twitter. So I basically wanted to answer 5 questions today. So the 5 questions are, what is WebAssembly? Let's first define what WebAssembly is. And then let's look into how it works. Why is it so fast? You'll probably understand it yourself, right? And then where is it being used? Where are its applications? And how do you and me get started with WebAssembly? How do we write application that integrates WebAssembly and make a really, really fast web application? So what is WebAssembly? So WebAssembly is a new, low-level, binary compiled format for programs in the web. Okay, that's a huge term. Low-level binary compiled format. That sounds a bit crazy, right? So what is it? Let me break it down for you. So it's an intermediate state that's not understood by your CPU, but still the browser would take that particular intermediate state and compile it for the CPU. So sounds crazy. Let's take a step back to understand it in a more clearer way. So if you want to write something in the web, right? You want to write a web application and want to perform some complex operations in it. Today, right now, you would write probably JavaScript, import a lot of node modules, and then you could bring your applications up. But there are certain things JavaScript is not good at. There are certain type of workload that JavaScript is not meant to do. So that's where you want languages like C++ or Rust system programming to come into place. You want to do some memory-intensive operations. You want to get more control. That's where you want system programming in the web. And WebAssembly basically does that for you. WebAssembly extends the web to these beautiful languages, so where you have more control over the web applications, and you get more native performance. So JavaScript was not designed to be fast, right? So in 1995, when JavaScript was introduced, performance was not the key thing that it was trying to solve. But JavaScript is fun, right? It's super easy to write JavaScript code. It's a very high-level language. But the dynamic nature of JavaScript comes with a cost. That cost, it's being a bit slow. And in today's world, when your applications are doing amazing things, like from word processing engines to hosting high-level APIs, you want your programs to be really, really fast. So if you look at this diagram here, it's like a miniature version of how a JavaScript code would be executed in the browser today. So your JavaScript code would come, and then you would pass it, you would compile it, and then you would re-optimize, where you basically have a profiler which sees which part of JavaScript code is being called continuously, and then I would re-optimize it. I would maybe like have a small compile format of it, and then execute. And there's always garbage collection which comes in the end. So this is how it looked like. So I'm not going to go into the details of it, but all that you need to understand, there's a virtual machine in your browser that has compilers and JavaScripts, a JavaScript engine that takes your scripts and renders for you from your code to your website. So what is WebAssembly bringing in? WebAssembly is bringing new opportunities in the space of PP. So that's what I call like 2P. That is portability and performance. So performance makes sense, right? Whenever you're writing system programming code, so performance already comes into place. So when you're comparing, when people say WebAssembly is fast, you're basically comparing C++ with JavaScript or Rust with JavaScript. So you're comparing system programming code with JavaScript. That's where WebAssembly is fast. And about portability, it's about taking this code and giving it as in deploying it across various architectures. So when you are deploying a website or a web application in the web, you don't know who your end target is, right? So you have different kind of hardwares, and then you depend on your browser to take care of that particular aspect. So WebAssembly takes care of that aspect for you. So how does it work? So today, if you want to run a code on the web, you would probably have a shared object file. It would get compiled to an intermediate format, and then that would be dispatched to a lot of architectures, right? And you use a lot of front-end and back-end tools like compilers, LLVM-based tools to do that. But WebAssembly here is going to, now let's see where WebAssembly is going to fit in. So WebAssembly is a general purpose virtual architecture. When I say that, it is not exactly existing. It is not a code that your CPU can understand. It's going to come somewhere in the between. That's where it comes in. So you basically have a C++ language. Right now, your tools will compile it to an intermediate format where your LLVM will optimize it, and then that would be compiled to a .wasm format. That is the WebAssembly format. Which your browser can then take and dispatch or deploy across different architectures or different hardwares. So what this basically means is your browser now would not parse or not would compile your code, but it would decode it because it's already at a low-level binary. And then optimizing is really easier because you're compiling ahead of time because of system programming. And then execution is far more faster. And you have better memory management and all those advantages of a system programming language. So where is WebAssembly exactly fitting in? It's not going to ask you for a new VM for running C++ code or Rust code. It's just going to fit in your existing stack itself. And it's as simple as that. And that's the reason why all the browser engines right now are supporting WebAssembly. WebAssembly is an open standard and is being supported by all the browsers these days. So why is WASM so fast? You probably have figured it now. It's thanks to the system programming, right? It is small in size. It's more compact. And then decoding is more faster than parsing because you don't have to now do dynamically, see through the code and compile. So it's decoding over there because it's already at a low level. It's an optimized code. The code is already compiled ahead of time. And you have better memory management. So let's look into some applications where WebAssembly is being currently deployed. So there are crazy games where people are using WebAssembly. So here, this is a game by Unity where there's this tank that goes and fires the other tank. It's a cool demo. And then, yeah. And there are other demos that are rendering high graphics on the web. Things like this were not possible before. Were possible, but were having like low FPS and things like that. But this is not it. Since you are using system programming code, WebAssembly is actually extending the whole amazing libraries like CV2 and all those libraries that were created. So much of engineering work has gone into those libraries. And WebAssembly can help you to utilize those work and bring it that to the web, thus bringing native performance to the web. So here is a demo of an face detection. So you would basically go browse up. I'm going to select a popular meme. And let me run the face detection. If you see the timing below, I hope that you can see it, it's almost 4 times faster than just JavaScript. And this would depend, could vary from machine to machine. So you could see from 10% to 800% of performance difference, depending on what kind of machine you're running at.
What is ASM?
Yeah, that's a good question. So WebAssembly is the direct successor of ASM.js. So in the simple words, ASM.js is a super complex JavaScript library that is like really optimized for a browser. And it can give you a lot of low-level access from JavaScript. So there are a lot of other areas and verticals in which WASM is currently being used. There's multimedia, Mozilla is writing a media parser, as I said before, OpenCV2 libraries, and things like that. So how do I get started? So the simplest way to get started with WebAssembly in your web application is to write a WebAssembly module and integrate with JavaScript. So that's what I'm going to do now. So there's this tool called WASM Explorer. So I'm going to write a function to calculate half of the given input. So, So this function takes an integer input and then returns the half of it. And then if I compile this code, okay, I think I'm not connected to the web, but this is thanks. But I already have compiled this for you. So you could basically see, let me just, is this visible? Okay. Better?
Yeah.
So WebAssembly syntaxes are pretty, very, very primitive in nature. So if you see here, I have a function which takes an integer parameter and then gives a result of an integer 32-bit parameter. And then what I'm basically doing here is I'm loading a value in the stack, the given value, that is x, and then I'm also loading another constant, and I'm dividing them by popping them both out, dividing and putting it back to the stack. So this looks simple, right? And the Firefox x86 assembly is what exactly is your binary level things, the ones and zeros that your machine can really understand. So you can download a WebAssembly, and what I'm going to do here is I've started a web server, and I'm going to use my WASM module to integrate it with my JavaScript application. To do that, first you have to, so what I'm doing here is first I'm downloading the WASM format, and then I'm converting it to an array buffer, then using that buffer, and I'm going to give it as an input to my WebAssembly instantiate module. So this would give me a promise request back, and the promise is fulfilled. So if you see here, there are basically two important keys here. One is instance and the module. So instance is nothing but the x86 code, that assembly level code that we saw, but with memory. And this particular code without a memory is the module. So this is of interest to me, and I'm going to load this to my global variable. And this gives me a function called exports that basically has my WebAssembly function, or the system programming code function. Now if I give an input like 12, it will return me the value. So it's as simple as that. You could just use your existing, you could write system programming code and bring it to the web using WebAssembly. So what are the reasons to use WebAssembly? You'd probably get a lot of amazing runtime performance. That's one good reason why you need to use WebAssembly. If you are doing some kind of memory intensive operations, WebAssembly comes into the picture. There's a lot of code reusability that you could do. Think about all those libraries out there which have, there's been like a lot of amazing engineering work done to it, like CV2 or Adobe PDF readers and things like that. Like, and you really don't want to re-implement the same thing in JavaScript. That would take you a lot more time. And so you could use WebAssembly over there to reuse those codes. Portability, now you don't have to actually worry about the different hardware that's out there, and you could basically use WebAssembly to ship it across different architectures, and enable new designs. WASM plus JS will open doors to a lot more innovation and faster applications. So going to production and supporting old browsers. So you write a C++ code, you could use tools like Emscripten, which are basically nothing but a mature LLVM backends that support to convert your system programming code to the WASM format. And for older versions of browser, you still could compile it to ASM.js, which is very fast, and then use tools like Binaryan to WASM. So this is where you could use these tools to actually load those heavy libraries that I was talking about, for example, CV2, like in the demo that I had showed you, and other libraries according to your application. So what is WebAssembly again? So it's a low-level binary format for programs. So it's not basically a machine code, but it's somewhere above that. It's an intermediate state, which a CP doesn't understand, but you need the browser to convert that particular code to ones and zeros. It's an open standard which is supported by all the browsers. So right now, as you saw, the four major players out there are supporting WebAssembly, and or you could currently go out there and build your own applications using WebAssembly to write faster web applications. It's a direct successor of ASM.js, and it's a general purpose virtual architecture. So here are some links that I would leave you guys with. You could go ahead and look into these links for getting a better understanding about the demos that I showed you and the code. So if you have any questions, please ask me, and thank you so much. Yeah.
Question. So Firefox 57, I think, supports only WebAssembly.
plugins add-ons.
Okay.
So the legacy add-ons are not running anymore. Is there any emulator that you can actually run these in WebAssembly, or just any workaround, or just have to rewrite the add-on?
Okay. If I understand your question right, you're asking. There's a lot of legacy add-ons that cannot be used in Firefox 57 right now, and I don't understand the WebAssembly part of it.
Well, the thing is, they're not running in WebAssembly, and Firefox is supporting only WebAssembly.
So regarding the legacy add-on, does it do something with the Web Extensions APIs? And I'm not sure how it is related to WASM. I can get back to you on that. But Firefox 57 supports WASM, so if you want to use WebAssembly modules in your code, or you want to write system programming code to maybe like, you know, improve the processing power of a particular part of your application, that's where I would use WebAssembly and integrate it with my existing code base. So that would give you a lot of performance boost. So what you're talking about, so you're asking if I could talk between languages, pass objects between languages. So yes, you could do that using the foreign function interface that the language extends. And it would be like you just have to focus on writing your system programming code and the way you're going to interact with JavaScript. And then WASM would just, or you can use mscripten to compile that particular system programming code to WASM format, and it would just work fine for you. Yes. Okay, so you're asking about the tooling support, and in short, so I'm not sure about D, but Rust compiler out of the box supports WASM. There are two, Clang is a compiler that you could use to convert your C code to WASM out of the box, and then of course there's mscripten, that's like really, really mature, and there's a lot of LLM based backends that are being developed right now. So yeah, the community is pretty active, and a lot of people are looking forward to the, create WASM modules. I'm not very sure. I think it's from it's been around like 42. I'm not really sure.
But it's actually very like it's been a while.
It's been a while. Like yeah, it's been a while. Yes. I've seen a couple of. So the question is like, can I just write system programming code to make websites and then not use JavaScript? I've not seen any production grade applications till now, but there are a lot of cool demos that I've seen, and they are really, really fast because you know system programming gives you all those advantages over in high level languages. Like you could write more memory intensive operations, you could access the memory, you have better memory management over there. So end of the day, system programming wins, but there's a lot of things that JavaScript is really, really mature at, and I don't see you know, any good reasons how JavaScript would die, or you know, system programming would be the next way to build websites. I think they both will work hand, you know, in parallel. So that's what I see is the key. Yes. Yes. I'm not able to follow. Can you repeat it once more?
The demo you showed.
Which demo?
The game demo.
Okay.
So, it is being drawn here in Java, and it's probably WebGL.
Yeah.
Where does the code live that is calling these WebGL functions? Is that part of the WebAssembly stuff, or is that like an invention in JavaScript?
So, the question is how has Unity built this? I'm not really sure about this. But I'm guessing that the WebGL part has been encoded into WebAssembly, and this is a total, if you see this as a total, it's a WebAssembly module that's powering this game.
What are the security mechanisms in place for restricting malicious WASM code?
Okay, that's a good question. So the question is like, what are the different kind of security vulnerabilities that are possible in WASM? So things that are possible in a system programming code are going to be possible with WASM as well. But the community itself, the LLVM compilers and the tools that are being built are taking care of this for you. But if you use languages like Rust, which are designed for safety and performance, you could probably avoid a lot of common system programming bugs. Someone else had a question.
Yeah, at which point does it enforce types? Like in your demo with a hash function, like it always takes an integer? But like JavaScript is this dynamically typed thing, everything is an object. So what would, for example, happen if I call this on a string?
Yes, I got it. It's a good question. So right now, you're asking like what are the different types that I could use in WebAssembly. So
Enforced.
So right now there are only like as far as I know there are only four types. That is integer, 32-bit, 64-bit, and float. And WebAssembly does not understand strings. So if you want to play around with strings, you probably want to put them in an array buffer and then use it in your JavaScript code. But you could always go back and refer to the WebAssembly site where they have documented all the kind of syntax and semantics over there. So it's pretty clean and. That's the key to it. If you want to play around, you need to go refer to that particular part.
Now, would you get a proper exception, or does your code just crash because you try to pass something which is not an integer?
It won't compile. The code won't compile.
For JavaScript, I mean, you can't enforce
your demo function. You put a string into it. What happens?
You would get an error.
So you would get a proper exception. Yes. So
yes. Yes. Someone else had a question. Okay, please.
I would like to pick up the security question again. What security mechanism is implemented in WASM? I would assume that it's also sandbox and same policy, the same original policy applies and stuff like that.
I didn't get the part. Security, what security problem are you talking about?
In WASM, what security context, what security policies are enforced by the browser? Is it the same as the JavaScript? Like, is it run in the sandbox?
Okay, so you're asking about what are the security policies that the browser is enforcing. I think it changes from browser to browser and the kind of tools that are being used. But for example, if you talk about the tool that you're using to convert your system programming code to WASM, like say I'm using mscripten. So mscripten takes care of all those security problems for you over there. So the community basically discusses over the different issues and builds that in the tool. So that's the key to it. And the different kind of benefits that you have in system programming, like whatever system programming code that you're writing in, so that advantages automatically come into the picture. So yeah, thank you so much. I think I have a minute more. Okay, I'm out of time. So thank you so much.